were raised by an overly critical and very disapproving mother, grew up, left home, went out on their own, and worked very, very hard and accumulated great amounts of money through their work ethics, all to impress their mom. So after the holidays, they discussed the Christmas gifts that they had given to their mother. And this was another way of them trying to win approval from her. And she was elderly at this point. So the first son, Milton, said, "For Christmas this year, I got Mom a big house. And I've moved her in, and she's there right now." Second son, Gerald, said, "I got her an over-the-top Mercedes with every kind of feature you could imagine, and a driver to drive her around in it." And the third son, Donald, smiled and said, "You both remember how much Mom enjoyed the Bible when we were growing up. Well, she can't see that well anymore, so I got her the kind of parrot that recites the entire Bible." And it took the elders in the church 12 years to teach this parrot how to do all of this, how to remember all these scriptures. Mama will just have to name the passage and the verse, and the parrot will recite it to her. Soon thereafter, Milton, Gerald, and Donald each received thank you notes from their mother. First one was to Milton. "Dear Milton, the house you built for me is ridiculously large. I live in only one room of it, and I spend the rest of my time cleaning the rest of the house. Thanks a lot." "Dear Gerald," she wrote to the second, "I am too old to travel, and I spend most of my time cleaning that big house. So I rarely use this Mercedes, and that driver that you hired is extremely rude. Thanks for nothing." However, to the third one she wrote, "My dearest Donald, you had the good sense to know what your mother likes. Thank you so much. That chicken was simply delicious." Oh. Gifts. Gifts of the season. So the gifts of the season might not include big, large houses and Mercedes and talking parrots or chickens, whatever. But those, we've been speaking about the whole month in the intangible gifts of spirit. Gifts of joy, of peace, of love, of self. That last week was self. Today's talk is entitled, "The Greatest Gift of All," which is a pretty bold statement. I mean, who am I to say, really, what the greatest gift of all is? You might have ideas of your own what the greatest gift could be for you. And quite frankly, after I got this title and thought about it, I intended to call it this or not. I kind of changed the title to "The Pretty Darn Important Gift." So this is a pretty darn important gift, I believe. And you can decide if it's the greatest gift of all for you. And it's appropriate that we talk about this gift coming upon the end of 2013. We have one more day left, and we begin a whole new year. So it's kind of like an appropriate gift and talk for this time of year. The gift that I think is pretty darn important is the gift of a clean slate. That's part of it. So we have a clean slate. The gift of infinite possibilities that is sitting right in front of us all of the time. Actually, we're immersed in infinite possibilities. The gift of living in a universe where everything is possible. Everything is possible. Just waiting for us to claim it. It is in the unformed ethers, and it is waiting to be brought into physical manifestation. We live in a field of energy that gives to us. Remember those laws, they work. They give us what we think, what we feel. So in my message research, I came across a poem that will set the tone for today's gift. And the gift, this gift, which I think is pretty darn important, is written by that wonderful, prolific writer, Anonymous. And it goes.
It's on the right side.
I am the new year. I am an unspoiled page in your book of time. I am your next chance at the art of living. I am your opportunity to practice what you have learned during the last 12 months of your life. All that you sought the past year and that failed to find is hidden in me. I am waiting for you to search it out again, this time with more determination. All the good that you tried to do and didn't achieve last year is mine to grant. Providing you have clearer intention and fewer conflicting beliefs. In me lies the potential of all that you dreamed but didn't dare to do. All that you hoped but did not perform. All that you prayed for and did not yet experience. Those dreams slumber lightly, waiting to be awakened by the touch of an enduring purpose. Yes, I am the new year. So there are two lines in that poem that I think are pretty darn important for us to get into this whole idea of the gift of a clean slate and limitless, infinite possibilities. Infinite. And so what are some of those infinite possibilities? Two parts of this poem that I really want to focus on before we go into that on this talk are all the good that you tried to do and didn't achieve last year is mine to grant. So we're going to talk about that. Providing you have a clearer intention and fewer conflicting beliefs. Very important. Clear intention and really self-serving, strong beliefs. Yes, I can. And yes, I will. And yes, I am. So I want to spend our time this morning helping you to achieve all the good that you didn't achieve last year. We're going to repurpose, if you will, refocus, and really get clear on what it is in this clean slate. We have a clean slate to create with right now. Right now, we have a clean slate. So by giving you an opportunity, which we're going to do a little bit later on, we're going to be releasing some of those old conflicting beliefs that might not be serving you. And by looking at the idea of getting the clearer intention, and my take on intention this morning might not be what you expect, so be sure that you stay awake. So we're going to look at fewer conflicting beliefs. Fewer conflicting beliefs, and release those beliefs that do not serve any longer. And you might have heard Mark Twain's story of the jumping frog of Calaveras County. This frog could outjump any frog around. He was the champion of all champions until one day a stranger came into town and he opened the frog's mouth and put quail buck in it, like his little bullets. The frog, heavy, was hunched over and he was so weighed down that he couldn't budge, and so he lost the race to the stranger's untrained frog. He didn't achieve the good that he desired because he was weighed down in a physical sense. We, on the other hand, don't achieve what we desire because sometimes, a lot of times, we're held down in a metaphysical sense. We're spiritually held down, emotionally held down, and a metaphysical, beyond physical. So in a moment, we're going to have a list of ways that we can metaphysically weigh ourselves down. But rather than have you sit there and having you say to yourself, yep, that's right, that's me, did that, I want you to think about something. I want you to have something in your mind think for a moment about something last year, because this year is rapidly ending. Think about something that you desire to achieve, but did not last year. But maybe you want to refocus again, repurpose again. Think about it. Was it a certain level of health or financial abundance? Was it having a deeply satisfying love relationship fulfilled? Was it joyous work, self-acceptance, greater social connections maybe? Was it feeling like you had truly made a difference on this planet in the evolution of humankind? Maybe that was it. What is one thing that you really desired to achieve but didn't seem to make it? And this is not a rhetorical question. And it's also not a question that you answer out loud, but I want you to answer it in your heart. So just take a moment and think of one thing. Think for a moment. Something that you would like to achieve this year. And didn't quite do it. So, with that in mind, think if in any way we weighed ourselves down, weighed yourself down, if any of these ways apply. Because these are different ways that we can weigh ourselves down. We have our clear focus, we know what we want, and then we weigh ourselves down by clinging to the mistakes we might have made, by doing them over, by worrying about them, and continually condemning ourselves for having made them. Could be a possibility. We weigh ourselves down by doubting our abilities. We weigh ourselves down by suspecting that we are not good enough, smart enough, attractive enough, or whatever enough. Maybe that crept in. We weigh ourselves down by continually looking at the hurdles in our path, all those blocks that can stop us, and we magnify them, make them even bigger, rather than looking at the finish line, rather than coming from the vision, aligning with that thing that you really desired to achieve, and then as if it already is there, instead of looking at the stumbling block. We weigh ourselves down with fear. Oh, that's a big one. We weigh ourselves down with fear that this or that circumstance is going to go wrong or work against us. Well, I might really screw this one up. So we don't do it. We weigh ourselves down with regret. Regret for what we did or didn't do, or say or didn't say. We weigh ourselves down with hurt, resentment or anger over circumstances or events that might have happened. We weigh ourselves down by having a belief that things outside of us, the economy, work, you might have a boss, spouse or ex-spouse, or former spouse, we don't do exes, might have control over us in some way. These are the kinds of things that we weigh ourselves down with. And so our manifestation of what we want then doesn't occur. So this morning I'm going to give you an opportunity to release some of these conflicting beliefs that you might have that have held you back, and to get the let out, if you will, so that you can begin the new year with a clean slate of limitless, infinite possibilities. That's where our faith in these spiritual teachings really comes in so, I wouldn't say handy, but so perfectly, is because we live in a universe where everything is possible if we yet believe, if we just believe it to be the truth. So it is necessary to release all thoughts as well as things that clutter up our lives. You know, I know many people, especially in the Prosperity Plus class, but a lot of people have been cleaning the clutter, cleaning the closets, cleaning the drawers, cleaning their homes. But as do we all think, this is for all of us, maybe I need to clean my thinking. Maybe I need to do that mind check. What am I thinking that I need to clean out and to release? That's a good thing. Because remember, once it's fully, completely, and really released, it won't come back. Fully, completely, and really released. So you're making a commitment through this exercise to let go. Let go of beliefs that don't serve you any longer. Let go of beating yourself up over stuff, focusing on things that don't really uplift you. Talking about stuff, everything that goes wrong in your life, or the economy, or whatever it is that we talk about that weighs us down. And this is all, we're doing the Four Agreements right now, and so those in that class know, and this is a book to live your life by, oh my goodness. Be impeccable with your word. Be impeccable with your word is so much more than what we are thinking, what we're speaking, it's what we're being as well. So be impeccable. Catch yourself. Become conscious of what you're thinking. Really important. So from then on we can evaluate and feel, because you can feel these conflict. They don't feel good. The conflicting beliefs do not feel good. And this is how you do it. Very simple. By saying, I am no longer entertaining that thought, because on Sunday, December 30th at 11:49, I released it. So this Sunday, we'll say 11:50, this Sunday, December 30th at 11:50, I released that. So maybe now just take a deep breath. Yeah, just think about that belief, or maybe two, that you might want to release. Really, really want to let it go. Enough already. Uncle, that belief. This is a brand new year. This is a brand new year. How are you being impeccable with your word right now? Think to yourself, I am no longer entertaining that thought. I am no longer a part of my belief system. That thought is no longer a part of my belief system. For now I am shifting into a thought, an affirmation that serves me, something that will help me move ahead to achieve my desires, to experience my desires. This year, I release any beliefs that stand in the way of this new powerful belief. Think about a belief. You've got to replace an old belief with a new belief. So you do that with a new thought. Every belief starts with a thought, with an affirmation. Remember, the new year is saying all the good that you tried to do and didn't achieve last year is mine to grant, providing you have a clearer intention and fewer conflicting beliefs. And so the second line of that poem, step into the greater possibilities by having that clearer intention, and an intention that's founded on love. So this morning I don't want to talk about specific intentions, specific visions, goals that you might have for your life. No, this morning I want to spend a few moments looking at the foundation on what, how these intentions are sitting in your life. How are they sitting in your life? Are they sitting on a foundation of love? For many of us, we're just kind of getting used to that concept, maybe. What does that even mean, of sitting on love? Think about it, it's in the heart, sitting on love. We all have the power to create. We have infinite possibilities, right? But if it is not founded on love, if it's not grounded and anchored on that thing called love, I believe that we could be misusing that power. We're not effectively manifesting. While we might get the very thing that we had been praying for or set the intention for, it really might just show up. Except that when it shows up, okay, I got it. The feeling inside is the same. It's still empty. It's still not fulfilled. So this is the shift that we are all moving into, on really getting that clear intention of what we want to feel. What is it we want to feel with our desired achievement, with our desire? What do we want to feel? So I have a couple of short readings. Peterim Sorokin, who was a Russian-born American sociologist who founded the Department of Sociology at Harvard University, after living through two or more of very harsh periods in history, right before and after the Russian Revolution, he wrote, "Someday mankind will learn what individuals have always known, that love is the only true creative force in the universe." And quoting from Architecture of Abundance by Lanidra Carroll, she writes, "Love is the essence of the mysterious empty space, the prana, plenum, life force, the very breath of the universe. It is the source of healing and miracles. The Christ, the Buddha, and many others have shown that it can be achieved in human form." And she goes on. "They taught that it is fully available, not out of your grasp. When science develops technology to measure the higher frequencies of love, as well as the frequencies of that empty space, which they're doing right now, it will discover what the sages have declared throughout time. They're all the same. It is all love. Love, in this elevated way of thinking and accessing, is the most profoundly balancing energy in the universe. It is the cohesive factor that allows everything, all life, to be held together. Love holds it all together. It is the platform," she says, "on which our dreams can take place. Love is the purest energy that exists, the energy that allows a sprout to become an oak tree. Here is the means to create heaven on earth." So you want to create your own heaven on earth, because that's where it is. It's right within you. It's not out there somewhere. It's right within you. You can live in heaven, or you can live in hell. That is your choice. So just think back for a moment on that goal, that desire, or that vision that you did not achieve last year. The one for which you now have this clean slate available, because you've released the conflicting beliefs. You just released them at 11:50. Released, gone, out of the building. We should do a burning ceremony. I was afraid to set off the alarms. I was going to do one, but maybe next year. Anyway, we're clearing out those conflicting beliefs. Think about that desire again. And this time, think about that desire sitting, just think about it, on a platform of love from the heart, from within. The kind of love that Lanidra Carroll spoke of, that Ernest Holmes, that Jesus, the Buddha, the Muhammad all refer to. They say God's love, right? Divine love. So get a clearer intention of the love that can propel your desire forward, because it will work. Remember, the universal laws always work, whether you're aware of them or not. So if you want to know what you're thinking, really, it is true. Look around at what you're experiencing in life and shift it. You can shift it. You can change it. You have that power. Let love point the way. As Ernest Holmes one of his famous quotes is, love points the way. Law makes the way possible. Love points the way, set the intention, and the law makes it all possible. It responds to our thinking automatically, whether we are conscious of it or not. The laws of cause and effect are always working, always working. So let love point the way. And really have your intention based on that strong foundation of love. Try it differently. If it hasn't worked before, you have nothing to lose. You have everything to gain. You have everything to gain. Remember, the law never fails. So in this brand new year, we have a brand new year. We have a clean slate right now. Brand new year that is upon us with this clean slate. Use it wisely. Have the clear intention and the belief that there are infinite possibilities available to each and every one of us. That is the truth. I really, really believe that. That is the truth. Right in front of us. If you can dream it, you can achieve it. Why not? Why not? If not you, who? Why not? The gift of the universe, then, in a universe where everything, this is the gift, everything in this universe, this universal energetic field that we live in, everything is absolutely possible. There are no lack of limitation. There is no lack of limitation in divine mind, in God. And since we're created out of this infinite source of good, truly, the only place the lack of limitation is in our thinking and in our emotional belief system. Someone once wrote, and I like this, you cannot go back and start over, my friend, but you can start right now and make a new end. That's good. Let me read that again. You cannot go back and start over, my friend, but you can start right now and make a new end. It's this moment forward that we're creating. Can't go backwards, we can only go forward. And we do that in this now moment. So I think it's a pretty darn important gift anyway. I think it's one of the greatest gifts of all, the gift of a clean slate, the gift of knowing that there are infinite possibilities that we can co-create in our lives. How wonderful is that? And every year I always have, Carol probably knows, I always have a little thing that I give the year, like a slogan or a mantra or something. So this year is, I'm living my dream in 2013. Mm-hmm. I'm living my dream in 2013. Mm-hmm. And so I say, Happy New Year, live that dream and live it well.
Amen. Amen. Amen.